Amit, welcome. Great to see you.
Welcome.
Hello, hello, hello. Hello from Seattle here. I'm as well in Seattle, enjoying the beautiful weather outside. So it's really awesome.
Indeed. You know, we truly appreciate it in Seattle when it does get beautiful.
Yes.
That is the awesome thing. Give a sense of who you are and what you do for AWS before we dive in.
Sure. I come from a deep background of networking and storage, and at AWS, I'm a product. My team manages all the products associated with either local hard disk or local SSDs. So if you find an EC2 product which has NVMe SSDs or hard disk, then me and my team are sort of involved in that.
Neat. So what are you here to talk to us about today?
Hey, I'm here to talk about what is it that we're doing in terms of bringing low latency workloads to cloud, and what kind of new products and new instances we have to offer to really help our customers meet their very tight SLAs as far as low latency workloads are considered. So wanted to give a glimpse of all the new technology that we are driving, the kind of innovation we are bringing on behalf of customers, and the new instances we are launching to really specifically target these workloads.
Okay, so tell us a bit about what is a low latency workload? Like why should our audience care?
That's a great question. So I think in general, low latency in a computing environment typically means that you want faster inter-process communication, you want faster inter-server communication, and then a high degree of predictability regarding latency and transaction response times. So that is important. And then apart from that, everybody's trying to push the throughput. So doing all of these things while really delivering high message rates. So if you look at the kind of workloads or segmentation that will fall into this, is if you think of real-time databases and analytics, fintech, HPC workloads, they all fall under this category. So if I have to click down on some real examples that you guys would that we all would come across in the edtech space, talk about segment data and ad bidding. So again, a very small amount of time to really figure out which ads do you want to bid for. It could be campaign data and post bid analytics in the edtech space. If you think about e-commerce and retail, then you're talking about fraud prevention and fraud detection, shopping cart experience. In case of fintech, algorithmic trading, online gaming, again, very, very popular and upcoming segment where you want to do in-app advertising, telecommunication, where you want to do real-time billing. So there are many such use cases that are there today and constantly evolving, where customers are looking for ideas and workloads that can really do data analytics in a fairly short amount of time. And I'm really talking about milliseconds, not even seconds. So microseconds to milliseconds end-to-end latency.
So are any customers running those low latency workloads in the cloud today, or is this something that's new and coming along?
That's a great question. So generally, we have been seeing momentum where customers are bringing their low latency workloads to cloud, predominantly because they want to optimize their costs, they want to drive higher performance, and ultimately reduce their OPEX. Now that said, when the data set that they are working on that is growing, what they really desire is they want to bring that data closer to processing. And that is where having instances with local NVMe SSDs have become really, really popular. To really address the low latency use cases, what we have really done is we have recently launched two new instances, IM4GN and IS4GN. These both are Graviton-based instances that got launched at reInvent last year. And then we have an upcoming instance, which is Intel third generation processor, Ice Lake-based processor, I4I instance, that is going to be launching very soon. And all these three instances are designed and exclusively enabled with AWS Nitro SSD and have 30 terabytes of NVMe storage. So yes, we do have instances which are highly optimized for low latency applications.
Mm. So let's rewind a tiny bit, because you said something really interesting there. You said we have AWS Nitro SSDs, and I've certainly blogged about those in the past. I think they're super cool, but probably new to some of our audience. So let's dive a little bit deeper into those.
Sure. So So let us first talk about why in the world we are designing a Nitro SSD, right? So again, going back to low latency, the most important part in terms of data access is going to be the high degree of predictability in terms of latency responsiveness. So that was really important. When you think about workloads like MySQL, Oracle Database, Microsoft SQL, or NoSQL databases like Spike, Redis, Couchbase, these characteristics are really important. So what we really did is we already had experience of running these workloads in cloud. So taking a look at those of what the usage patterns are, and then bringing in this requirements that, hey, the customers want access to this data in a very predictable and low latency fashion. That is where the whole idea of AWS Nitro SSD came into picture, where we designed the whole SSD from grounds up and really enable up to 60% lower latency and up to 75% lower latency variability. So again, an innovation that AWS drove completely on behalf of the customer. And Jeff, as you're aware, this is not the first time we're doing something like this for our customers, right? There are many such examples, Graviton, the Nitro system, the Trainium, the Infertia. So AWS Nitro SSD is just another example of AWS driving innovation on behalf of customers.
I love it. It's such to me a great counterexample of a thing that I used to hear way, way back in the early days of AWS and EC2, where people would look and they'd listen a bit and they say, oh, this is just a bunch of commodity hardware in a rack, right? And it's like, no, not really. We've done a lot of special things. And in those early days, we couldn't talk so much about the details, but now we actually can. And like this to me is an amazing example of how much it isn't commodity and how we really listen to our customers and build something that's really finely tuned to meet their needs.
Yeah, so I think let me add a little bit more details here. So by the way, the Nitro SSD that comes into these three new instances, that is not the first generation. This is in fact the second generation of SSD. The first one was enabled for EBS, and then ultimately in terms of customer benefit, if you think about like we did some benchmarking with Redis and Skylar DB. And we see up to 2.9x to 2.7x throughput improvement with the new I4I instances. That is a significant improvement that these new instances are going to provide. When you talk about Graviton-based instances, what we observed is Splunk was able to get 50% reduction in search time with the Nitro instances. And Sprinklr, again, saw 50% reduction in their throughput time for their search latency. So again, significant improvement that we're able to deliver with instances exclusively enabled with Nitro SSD.
Hey, so we had a question come in on the chat from newbie0123. He said, is AWS Nitro, is it completely transparent to the software, right? Or are there any potential conflicts that they might need to worry about or be aware of? I can't imagine there is, but.
No, there is. So when we say AWS Nitro, there can be two different things. AWS Nitro as a whole, it should be completely transparent. So there should be no reason for you to do anything different when you're working with our virtualized instances. When it comes to AWS Nitro SSD, again, it is completely transparent because guess what? These are Nitro SSDs are based on NVMe specs, which is a standard specification. So again, in terms of how the capacity gets allocated to the application, completely transparent.
So I mean, one thing that I picked up on that you've I think hinted at a couple different times, you've certainly talked about performance as an absolute number, but you've also talked, or at least dropped a lot of interesting hints about, well, the variability matters as well. So that I guess the inverse of variability is probably predictability. So am I hearing the right things there?
Yes. So this was an interesting experience for me because when we typically look at SSDs today, we hear, the IOPS, the how much IOPS can you really deliver and how much throughput can you deliver? And that is what people mostly talk about, or the SSD vendors mostly talk about. But when you really start digging into the details of what is it that the customers really care, it turns out that rather than the raw SSD IOPS number or a raw throughput number, what they care about is how much throughput can be delivered by an SSD for a given amount of time. So this was a big aha moment for us, where ultimately what we did is that we started figuring out how do we optimize our Nitro SSDs and test it such that we can continue to increase our throughput for a given amount of time. So that is where we really started optimizing. And the only way we thought that we can really bring this characteristics for our customers is we start owning the whole flash translation mm-hmm. layer. And then that is where the whole innovation comes in, where the Nitro SSD builds an in-house AWS developed flash translation layer that really optimizes the amount of throughput or IOPS you can deliver for a given amount of latency.
Interesting. So when you say kind of overall throughput, what, for some reason, this picture came to mind of this very wide highway and all these cars and trucks, and we're trying to get them down the highway just as quickly as possible.
Yeah. So think of it this way: like if everybody is running at variable speeds, then for you to ever predict that, okay, how much time is it going to take from me to sitting in my home in Seattle to reach the Seattle airport? It can be 25 minutes, and it can be 1 hour. It's all variable, so very difficult to predict and plan my commute. Versus if we say that, hey, the lanes that we're creating for people to drive on, and there's a certain speed limit and everybody adheres to that, then probably the range is going to be much more shorter, of anywhere from 25 minutes to 30 minutes. And that is the whole idea, that rather than pushing for something for one case where, oh, in one scenario, I can drive to airport in 15 minutes, it is more about really trying to make sure that there is a very consistent and predictable band where the customers can rely on and they can meet their customer SLA. That is the whole innovation that we are driving.
I would love to be able to drive to the airport consistently in 15 minutes, and I don't live that far away, frankly.
Yeah, it's funny, in those situations, you have to effectively plan for worst case. The average isn't very good in a situation like I need to be at the airport. It's the it's the predictability of, I can always get there in 15 minutes. Okay. So you talked a little bit about this whole concept we have at AWS and within the EC2 team of the storage optimization in storage optimized instances. So what's our whole kind of big picture thinking there?
Okay. So today we already have instances called I3 and I3EN, and they have been there for a few years. So I'm going to not talk about that, but really focus on the new instances that we have recently launched and about to launch. So we have got IM4GN and IS4GN, again, launched at reInvent. They have 30 terabytes of Nitro SSD, so which means that you get the benefit of lower latency and lower latency variability. IM4GN is Graviton, again, Graviton-based instance, very comparable to an I3 instance, but the new benefits that you would see is that it will support up to 100 gig of networking bandwidth, so significant improvement there, 38 gigabit of EBS bandwidth. It is optimized for workloads that can work with 4 gigabytes of memory per vCPU. In terms of cost, this is the kicker, 44% lower dollar per terabyte. So significantly better in terms of dollar per terabyte compared to I3, and 40% better price performance compared to I3. So again, big TCO savings and price performance advantages that you'll get with IM4GN. If you talk about IS4GN, it is more comparable to I3EN instance. So IS4GN supports 50 gig of network bandwidth, 19 gig of EBS bandwidth, optimized for workloads with 6 gigabyte of memory per vCPU. And again, 15% lower dollar per terabyte. So IS4GN is the lowest dollar per terabyte that EC2 has to offer anywhere. So this is the lowest dollar per terabyte, and up to 48% better compute performance than I3EN.
So lower cost per terabyte, but also all the other benefits, including the increased predictability and the lower variability.
Right. And then we have the upcoming I4I instance, which is enabled with the latest generation of Intel Xeon processor, Ice Lake. So again, comes with Nitro SSD, 30 terabytes of Nitro SSD, and 30% price performance benefit compared to I3. So if you have a workload which is predominantly optimized for x86, then I4I is going to be a great instance for you to look at. If you have workload that would very well easily map to Graviton-based instances, then IM4GN, IS4GN is going to be a path to significantly reducing your TCO and really driving performance significantly higher.
Interesting. That's a really interesting instance name, given that the two I's actually have different meanings, but such is the limitations of alphabets and encoding systems.
Yeah, meaning tell me about it. Naming, as you can see with all the namings, it's a fun exercise for me.
Mm-hmm.
Naming is hard.
Yeah. No kidding. This has been super, super interesting. Where are we going to take the Nitro SSD next?
So interesting. So our ultimately our commitment to our customers is that we are always going to reduce cost. So and any kind of a storage optimized instance, $1 per terabyte is where the biggest cost is. So our goal is that over the years, using Nitro SSD, we're going to, number one, keep on reducing our cost for our customers. So ultimately reduce their TCO. Make the performance more predictable. So we are not done yet. We'll continue to improve and make the performance more and more predictable. And then what we are also planning to enable is, over a period of time, you will see a lot more new capabilities that will be enabled based on the Nitro system and the Nitro SSD. So again, we'll continue to develop and innovate further using the Nitro system and the Nitro SSD platform.
Totally awesome. Steve, do you have any more questions?
No, I don't. Just thanks, Amit, for coming along and talking about it. It's just great.
Oh, actually, before you go, Amit, we actually got one really awesome question from Noobie 123. Let me pull this one up. I love this question. Do the Nitro benefits affect serverless services performance, such as Lambda and so forth?
That is a good question.
So great question. So in terms of Nitro, if you're running Lambda services on an iFamily instance like the IM4GN, IS4GN, and I4I, then yes, they would benefit because the access to data is going to be significantly faster. So even though you have got all these smaller services, the fact that the service time to complete that particular task is going to be shortening quite a bit, ultimately that will result in better performance for the overall Lambda service.
Yeah, that's a great question. And to me, it also points out that, especially with our higher level services, we continue to innovate beneath the surface and give those innovations to our customers. So things get better, faster, and more cost effective for our customers without the customer often even having to do anything. I just love that idea that it just gets better inside.
Yep, absolutely.
Great. All right, okay, Amit, this has been really fun. Really enjoyed speaking with you and appreciate you taking the time to be here.
Okay, thank you guys. Ciao.